Okay, so I think we have 130 participants. I think we get started. Hello, everyone. Thank you all for attending this week's installment of the Polariton Chemistry webinar series. My name is Kai Schwenicke, and I am honored to introduce today's speaker, Professor Abraham Nitzan from the University of Pennsylvania. Before I begin, though, the schedule and mechanics of these webinars. These webinars are hosted every Wednesday at 9 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. You can follow us on Twitter and on Facebook to get current updates on our upcoming featured speakers. We post upcoming speakers as events on our Polariton Chemistry Facebook page. We'd also like this page, though, to grow into a place for scientific discourse. For example, if you have questions about a paper you're currently reading or you find interesting, we encourage you to post your question and comments on this Facebook page. We are also uploading recordings of these webinars on our Polariton Chemistry Webinars YouTube channel. In case you missed a webinar or you'd like to rewatch a presentation. We are encouraged by the amount of popularity these webinars have gained in such a short amount of time. Last week's seminar hosted a total of 218 attendees, which is the most we have attained thus far. And we are also excited by the fact that these webinars have reached people in the community from across the globe. Finally, I'd like to go over the mechanics of attendee participation during today's talk. During the talk, all attendees' audio and videos are muted. During the talk, if you have a question, you may use the raise hand option at the bottom of your screen. I will then be notified and then unmute your audio, and then you'll be able to ask your question directly to the speaker. You may also type up your questions in the Q&A option at the bottom of your screen. And then at the end of the talk, I will then read from this list and answer some questions from there. You can also interact with other the group through the chat option. And for the interest of time though, questions by the speaker will be answer directly through raise hand and the Q&A option, but feel free to post questions to the group through the chat option. And with that, I'd like to introduce today's speaker, Professor Abraham Nitzan. Currently, he's a professor of chemistry at the University of Pennsylvania. He received his master's in chemistry from the Hebrew University, Jerusalem, and received his PhD in chemistry from Tel Aviv University. As a professor at Tel Aviv University, he served as both the chairman of the chemistry department, the dean of the Sackler Facility of Exact Sciences, the director of the Sackler Institute of Advanced Studies, and the Rika and Iser Kodas Chair of Chemical Dynamics. He has also been a visiting professor at places such as Northwestern, University of Konstanz, Free University of Berlin, and Beijing University. And he has also served as a consultant for Bell Labs. He has received numerous awards, such as the Alexander von Humboldt Award, the Kalthoff Prize, the Manchot Award, the Israel Prize in Chemistry, the Mulliken Lecture and Medal, the Hirschfelder Prize in Theoretical Chemistry, and the Pitzer Lecture. He is also a Fulbright Fellow and a AAAS Fellow. And in 2006, he published his renowned book, The Chemical Dynamics and Chemical Dynamics in Condensed Phases. And then his research interests include studying chemical reactions, energy and charge transfer processes in condensed phase in molecular systems, as well as in nanojunctions. And with that, Professor Nitzan, if you could share your screen.
Okay. Do I start?
Yeah. When you're ready.
Okay. Good morning, everyone, and thank you very much for inviting me for this forum. This is really impressive what you're doing here. Let me start by thanking Ray and Joel and Kai for doing all this for us. And I will also thank my co-workers. Those that are in red here are the ones I will present the work today, but I enjoyed working with all of them. Maxim Sukarev is in Arizona State, Kristen Karsberg is in Copenhagen, Renaud is in Bordeaux, and the rest of the group on the bottom line here are all at the University of Pennsylvania. Our funding over the years came from NSF. Now it is NSF, it was BSF until very recently. ISF is the Israel Science Foundation and the European ERC. Let me start with the things I was really focusing on until just a few years ago, which are molecular junctions. And there the focus is on electron transport, in fact, between two electrodes, as you see here on the top. You have gold electrodes between right and left. There is a molecule in between. The focus, I say, is on electrical conductivity, but much of the interest in these things, which are very much like small cavities, is in the interaction with light. Basically, you see here the five main focuses of research, especially if you are aiming at nanotechnology. Fabrication is what we do not do since we are a theoretical group. Stability of junction is important. Molecules can run away easily if they get hot. A characterization to know whether a molecule is there or not, functionality, you want it to do something and you want to control what it is doing. As you see, several of these things are using light. Light is certainly something you can characterize with, you can impose functionality on, and you can control. And I will show you some examples of what we have been doing and we are still doing in some ways in this direction. So, basically, what we have is such a nanocavity, but I will look at it as a molecular conduction junction. But the idea is to shine a light on it and see what light can do on such systems. So let me give you an example, actually a very, I think, impressive experimental achievement by a co-worker in the University of Berlin. Tsufan Guo and his group. And what you have here is a molecule between two graphene electrodes in this case. And it turns out that this structure, you can switch conduction on and off, as you see here, basically by shining light at the UV to switch it on, and then shining another pulse at the visible to switch it off. So basically you use light as a switch mechanism. We were at the theoretical end trying to understand the mechanism of what is going on. There is also this interesting fluctuations that you see at the conduction phase, which actually you trace to the fact that these are not one state, but two states that you fluctuate between. So there are a lot of interesting physics that is not related to today's talk. I just mentioned this in passing. Here is another example that will become more related to what we'll say later. Here you put voltage again between two electrodes and light is coming out. Basically you convert electrical energy into light. In order to see this light, you do not want to put your molecules directly on the metal because dissipation takes over. Here the surface is indium tin oxide, which is a transparent semiconductor. If the voltage is large enough, you can excite photons, photons are coming out, the voltage becomes still larger, the junction is destroyed just by heating. This is the stability issue I mentioned before. Let's see, this is where you take the same idea and carry it to actually applications in the group of Wilson Ho and co-workers. you see here the mechanism they propose for light emission. Electrons come from a left electrode. This has the Fermi energy separating occupied and empty states. Electrons come from the Fermi energy of the left electrodes, populate an excited molecular level that actually can go to the ground state, putting photons out. But you can scan using this device, you can scan above the molecule, and this is porphyrin molecule, and you can see the different regions in the molecule, region 1, 2, 3, and 4, emit light at different structures. So this is actually a very sensitive probe on molecular structure that certainly can be used for diagnostics. Now, there is an interesting issue of energy conversion in these adlantians. Basically, if this oscillator presents a photon that you want to excite, clearly, in order to excite, you have to have a voltage bias, which is at least as large as this photon. And so you expect a threshold for photon emission. You cannot emit photons at higher energies than the voltage allows you to. And you can see this experimental. You see that when you increase the voltage in this work from 2014, the threshold for light emission is moving more and more to the blue because you have more energy to generate light with. On the other hand, there are also this kind of experimental results coming from Schall and Brand lab quite some time ago, more than 10 years ago. Here, the voltage threshold is here. According to the previous argument, you should not see any photons coming out at higher energies. Still, you see a large peak at higher energies, which means that you actually have to connect the energies of at least two electrons in order to see a light emitting in this range. And in fact, this is the mechanism. Basically, now you see light that is dependent on electron-electron correlation. In fact, when you do the theory, I don't want you to look at all these equations. I just want you to focus on the last line here. You see that the key physical process is current fluctuations. This is current-current correlation function in the junctions. You have to have this current noise, or if you want, occupation noise of the junction in order to see the light emission. When you finish the theory, doing theory along these lines, you can actually compute the spectrum of this over-threshold light that comes out, the one that comes at energy above the voltage, and you get, with fitting of a couple of parameters, a good agreement with this experiment. This work is still going on. This is not by our group, but in Carlsberg and Schall's, in fact, mostly the experimental group by Schall, and there are very interesting results still coming out in this direction. Let's take another thing, Raman scattering. Raman scattering is a great diagnostic tool in molecular systems. If you have a junction, this is actually how you prepare what is called the break junction. You have a metal wire that you put a load on to just break it at some point. This is a really nano-sized break here. If a molecule like this OPV3 enters here and sits here, you can see it's Raman scattering. And if you are in the molecular junction business, I mentioned stability before, heat generation is a large stability issue. To be able to measure the temperature of a molecule in a conduction junction is an important achievement. Here you see Raman scattering is a tool for measure temperature because Raman has two components, the Stokes and the antistokes. The ratio between them directly relates to the temperature in the junction, or really to the vibrational occupation of vibrational modes. And here you see for different vibrational modes how their temperature depends on the voltage coming out of such a Raman experiment. There are a lot of interesting physical issues we do not go today into, like the fact that you have different vibrations seeing different temperatures, as you see here, even though this is the same system. And this is not surprising. This is a non-equilibrium system. Temperature is not really well defined. You can fit temperature to vibrational occupation, and seeing different temperatures just mean that different vibrational modes are coupled to the conduction process differently, so they get heated differently if you are out of equilibrium. There is also interesting thing about, I don't think you can see it in this side of the graph, about frequency change as a function of voltage here. And basically you can do the theory both of the temperature rise and the frequency change, but I will not go into details. So this is just an anecdotal account of what you can do when you put light on small constrictions containing molecules. I talked about light generated out of voltage. Of course, photovoltaic cells are systems and will generate voltage and current out of light. It's the same kind of, if you are a theoretician, it's the same kind of system. You have metal on the left, metal on the right, occupied levels, unoccupied levels. Now, light is coming in as sunlight, exciting the molecules, and you can see that you can generate voltage out of it. Basically, the same kind of Hamiltonians and theory will give you light generation out of voltage or voltage generation out of light, depending on what are your boundary conditions and mostly on what is actually driving the system. Is sunlight driving the system or any light driving the system, or is it voltage that it drives the system? Now, when I am giving talks about these subjects, I usually put everything in this into this transparency under the title Junction Spectroscopy. And basically the focus is what in such an environment, a molecule in a small constriction between this, between two metals, what is different from standard spectroscopy, say, of a molecule in solution? And here is the list. Basically, the first one is most closely related to today's talk that I will come in come to very soon. The local radiation field is different. This is radiation field between two metal boundaries. You can have basically in the old days, the focus was on what is called surface enhanced spectroscopy. Today we talk about exciton plasmon excitations, so exciton cavity mode excitations. I will come to these issues as they relate to today's talk in a few more transparencies. But there are other effects to focus on which are very important when you study molecules in conduction junctions. Lifetime becomes shorter. Molecules sitting on a metal, there is a channel for energy dissipation, which is just exciting electron hole pairs in the metal. This is a very efficient way to for the molecule losing its energy. I mentioned before that people can see light coming out of junctions, but this is never when the molecule sits directly on the metal. In one case, it was indium tin oxide. That was one of the surfaces, the surface where the molecule is sitting on. In the second one, I did not mention before, you put a layer of salt, just sodium chloride, between the metal and the molecule in order to see light emission out of this conduction junction. I mentioned you can see light-induced current, you can see current-induced light. You have another ruler, basically two more rulers in this kind of spectroscopy. Spectroscopy depends on the voltage you put on the junctions. It depends on the distance between the molecule and the metal walls. I mentioned that Raman scattering is a very important tool in these studies. And I did not yet mention there is what is called surface selection rules. The symmetry of molecule in a junction is very different from symmetry of molecule in solution. So any selection rules based on symmetry will be changed or destroyed in the junction. So this is the things at least to keep in mind when we study this system. So this was the focus of our research until just a short number of years. And then Tal Schwartz joined the chemistry department in Tel Aviv University when I was at that time. And he told me all about his experiments when he was a postdoc in the group of Thomas Ebbesen. And this opened a new line, basically the same kind of systems, molecules between metals with light. But this came, there was very exciting result that I will mention, basically seeing what I would say, effect of the junction or the cavity environment on chemical properties of molecules and optical properties of molecules in ways we did not anticipate before. In particular, this observation of collective behavior. The response of a molecule to light depends on the number of molecules around it in a non-trivial way. So what I'm going to tell you about today is several more works that came out of this interest in our group. I also mentioned the collaborators in this work. Alex Semanov is postdoc with my group in Pennsylvania, about to start a new job at NOAA, which is the agency that studies, among other things, hurricanes. So we'll go from cavities to hurricanes in a short while. Monosil Mondal and Alex Semanov, Michael Oksha, collaborate on another work. This is a collaborative experimental theoretical work with Renaud Vallée and Maxime Soukarev. And Tao Li and Joe Subotnik collaborate with me on some work related to collective effects that I will tell you about in a moment. So let's start. I will start with cavity effects on electron transfer for molecules located in such cavities. So basically, this was what we started to do when we learned about this stuff. What happens when you put molecules in junctions? And electron transfer is a process where electrons go from one side of a system to another, and that's likely to be affected by the this cavity environment. So let's just remember what electron transfer is about. These are two potential surfaces. This is electronic energy as a function of nuclear configuration for two electronic states, call one of them a donor and another an acceptor. And each one has an equilibrium configuration, because if electron goes from one side of the system to another side of the system, the nuclear configuration responds to it. There is an equilibrium one, and there is energy as a function of configuration. In the standard theory of electron transfer due to Marcus, this is the taken as parabolas. And in fact, you can show that on the level of linear response theory, a parabolic description of these potential surfaces, response of nuclear configuration to local electronic charge, is a good approximation. If electron starts on the left, the activation energy to go from left to right is this height here, because of the timescale separation between electron dynamics and nuclear dynamics. Electron will go from left to right on such a timescale that nuclei do not move. And because they do not move, electron transfer is elastic. It conserves electronic energy. So it can happen only if the two electronic energies on the state on the left, the donor, and on the right is the same, which means this crossing point. So this is the activation energy. And this activation energy depends on the coupling between the donor and acceptor states. This coupling can be expressed in terms of this distance. This distance is the nuclear response, the distance between equilibrium nuclear configuration from one electronic state and another is basically the nuclear response to the electronic motion, and this is the coupling between these two states. In fact, once you realize that this is the model for electron transfer, and if you are Rudy Marcus, you make the prediction that as you change the energies of the donor and acceptor state, this delta E that you see here, this energy, as you change this energy, the activation energy, this energy here, the energy between the bottom of the donor state and the crossing point, will go down, but then it will go up again. So you expect, you make a prediction that eventually is seen in experiment. You change this, what you can call driving energy of the reaction, activation energy goes up and then it goes down. This was observed in the early 80s, which led to the Marcus Nobel Prize in the early 90s. So now we want to put it all, this is a molecule. The red here is an excess electron that will change location from one side of the molecule to another. If we are Marcus, the kind of theory we do, we do not, Marcus did not work in this representation, work in the energy representation. So you have a donor state, you have an acceptor state, you have an environment. This is just modeled as a collection of bosons here. In Marcus theory, this was a dielectric response, or the dielectric response of the environment entered. I put it here as a bus of bosons. This bus of bosons changed the energy of the acceptor relative to the donor. So this is the coupling here. And this is the non-adiabatic coupling between, this is the coupling to the bosonic environment, to the dielectric solvent. And this is the non-adiabatic coupling between donor and acceptor. So this is just an energy representation of this Hamiltonian. And now we want to put it all in a cavity, which means we want to put the photon field, we take one cavity mode here. So this is the cavity mode. This is in the dipole electric field representation. This is the dipole in the system. This is the excess electron and the rest of the molecule, the electric field, which is expressed in terms of the cavity mode here. And the last term that you see here is the self-interaction of the dipole, also part of the electromagnetic coupling between the molecular dipole and the electric field. So you want to see what the effect of these terms here on the electron transfer reaction. And now this Hamiltonian looks formidable enough, but when you look at it, basically what you have here is a two-level system, donor and acceptor, coupled to a bosonic system. The bosonic system is made of two kinds of bosons. This is the thermal environment, just a set of bosons, or the dielectric environment. These lambdas can be expressed in terms of the dielectric function of the solvent. And then there is another boson environment, which is the cavity mode that the molecule is coupled on. So you can imagine that the theory cannot be that different, just a two-level system coupled to a boson mode, just another spin boson Hamiltonian, except that there is a new kind of coupling, the coupling of a molecule of, if you want, this excess charge that is moving to the cavity environment. So what you're going to see are new kind of coupling elements expressed in terms of this dipole matrix elements, the excess electron dipole contribution in the donor and in the acceptor, and the, if you want, transition dipole for this excess electron within donor and acceptor. What you'll see in the next transparencies are coupling elements called G and T that are related to this dipole matrix elements. So this is, if you want, the new Hamiltonian to study electron transfer in. I don't want you to look at it, I just want you to look at the colors. There are blue color and red color here. If I keep only the blue, this is the Marcus theory. That is, if I use this Hamiltonian to calculate electron transfer rate from donor to acceptor and go to the high temperature limit, which is the limit where Marcus did his theory, I will get the Marcus rate for electron transfer. And what do we see in this blue part? Here is the donor and acceptor and the thermal environment. And the coupling between them is expressed after what is called polaron transformation in terms of these terms, which basically says that the bosons in the environments are sensitive to where the electron is. This lambda is the response of the environment to changing the charge distribution in the electronic systems. And then there are these non-adiabatic coupling terms that appears there. So everything blue is just the Marcus theory. This is all I want you to remember here. The red part is what the cavity does for us. And what does it do for us? Another boson. Here is the cavity boson. And a lot of red terms, which actually look very similar to the blue terms. Here you see another, if you want, effect, a term like this. This is the thermal environment equilibrium shift due to charge transfer. And this is the cavity response to this same charge transfer with the new coupling elements that we can calculate. Then there is an addition to the non-adiabatic coupling, again, with coupling elements that we can calculate. But then there are two more terms here, which still look the same with one difference. in addition to terms that give rise to electron transfer, there are terms that can generate or eliminate a photon in the cavity. So these are terms that will be responsible for photon-assisted electron transfer. I transfer electron from one side to another while eliminating or generating a photon in the cavity mode. So this is the physical structure of this Hamiltonian, and let's talk physics about it. First, I said that you can generate photons while transferring.
Professor, we have a question.
Yes, please.
Go ahead.
Hi. I was curious, what is your ground state? Because the polaron transformation will have some effect on the equilibrium density operator, if I may call it. So that was the question.
The equilibrium, I guess I do not understand your question, because in my world, equilibrium density is a physical property. The operator may look different, but the physical property, I'm sure you agree, remains the same. But putting this aside, the ground state can be one of these states, either the donor or the acceptor. Usually in many experiments, this is a state below both of them. So usually electron transfer process in many experiments starts by exciting a system to start with a donor state, and then following in time, electron transfer to an acceptor state. Standard in many experiments, but you can have in electrochemistry, you can have electron transfer in ground state. So I have a molecule in the ground state. I bring another molecule in a close vicinity, and this ground state is now not the lowest energy state of the system. There is another low energy state, and electron will go to the other state. Now, please ask more, because I need maybe to understand.
So just to clarify my question, since it was a momentum coupling to the cavity mode, I was expecting that the erstwhile ground state without the cavity, this will now will be delocalized over the cavity mode as well. So that was the reason I was...
I guess that perhaps I do not understand it completely, but momentum coupling is just, you know, one of the representations. Every time I write a coupling between matter and light, if this is a electric field in standard representations, it is the momentum operator that comes in, A dagger minus A. It makes little difference, because the cavity mode is a harmonic oscillator. What I call momentum and what I call coordinate is just a choice. So I can replace the language. I could call it Q and not P, and the mathematics will remain the same. So if this is easier for you to think of this as a coordinate, it's fine. I mean, there is really, mathematically, there is no difference. But again, perhaps I just missed your direction here.
Maybe I can write an email.
please do. I would like to understand more of what you're driving at. Anyway, I say that one way to assist electron transfer is by generating photon while transferring electron. And in fact, we saw it before when I talked to you about molecular conduction junctions. We can generate light while moving electrons from right electrode to left electrode. This can happen here, but see how it happens. Here you have the donor without a photon and acceptor without the photon. So in the usual electron transfer Markov theory, if you want, is just the two blue parabolas, and electron will go from the donor to the acceptor. So I will start in this state and I will end with electron in the other states. All this energy will go to the environment. This is the acceptor with one more photon. And you see that I cannot really expect to generate a photon here, because the activation energy, as we said before, is going to this crossing point here. And this activation energy is higher if the acceptor has one more photon. This is what is called the Markov normal regime. Remember before I showed you that the activation energy goes up and then down as this blue surface and donor surface will change positions horizontally relative to each other. Like here, when I go to the Marcus inverted regime, now the activation energy is the distance between this ground state and this crossing point. The red line did not change position at all, but now you see that you can generate photons without activation energy in this particular drawing. So in fact, here electron transfer will be preferred while generating photons. Basically what I'm saying, in the Marcus inverted regime, when you are in a cavity, you are more likely to transfer electron while generating photons than if to transfer electron without generating photon. The activation energy to generate photon is lower than the activation energy not to generate photon. There is another issue that I did not mention before. Everything I wrote here is under the assumption that the cavity mode is slow relative to the electronic transition. Basically, the cavity mode plays a role of another nuclear motion. This is not the usual state. It is the usual state in what we call vibrational strong coupling, because there we aim at slow cavity mode. When you do the theory, there is also the standard limit where the cavity mode is as fast or faster than the time scale of electron dynamics in the system. And in this case, in fact, there is very little effect of the cavity on the electron transfer reaction, except when you can generate photons. So this happens also when the cavity mode is fast relative to the electronic motion. But let's go on for a while with the slow limit, and let me show you a calculation. Basically, we took a cavity of this kind. This is a
Professor, we have another question.
Yes, please.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Sorry, can you go back one slide? I'm really sorry for slowing down the presentation. So this reminds me a lot of the, I guess, like the extensions of Marcus theory, you know, that incorporate high frequency quantum vibrations. I'm wondering if you can also comment on the changes to the coupling matrix elements between this donor state with zero photons and the acceptor state with one photon.
Yes, in fact, first, you're right. I mean, if you're a cavity mode is another vibration, and this can be high energy vibration or low energy vibration, or it can be higher than vibrations, right? It can be electronic time scale. This is the point I made. But let's suppose it is a vibration. You see it here. So the additional coupling to this vibration is everything red that you see here, where the red couplings are defined here in terms of orbitals on the donor and the acceptor. So basically what you see are new coupling. This will be the coupling in Jotner Marcus, the Jotner version of the Marcus theory to the this high vibration, but this is now a cavity mode. So the coupling is a dipolar coupling that you see on the right side of the transparency. And then there is a possibility to also generate a photon in the Jotner theory. I don't know how well you're familiar with it. There is something called accepting modes and promoting modes. Accepting modes are modes that just contribute what we call Frank-Condon factors to the rate. Promoting modes can also change their populations, and this is what here appears as generating the photon in the cavity mode. Does it answer the question?
Yes, yes, thank you so much.
Okay, so let me just show you a result that Alex got in this kind of cavity. I emphasize that this is a single molecule theory. So we do not rely with possible shortcomings. The question is whether the experiment can be done, but we do not rely on collective effects here. So we look for cavities that do not have neat collective effects, where the coupling is strong enough to see single molecule expressions. I will come back to this in a moment, but this is the result you get. If the cavity mode is fast, you basically see, these are the Marcus normal regime and inverted regime. This is the electron transfer rate as a function of the driving force, which is the energy difference between donor and acceptor. rate goes up and then goes down. But here you see, in a fast mode, you see no effect on the rate, except that when you have enough energy, you can generate photon in the mode, and then you see this slide. But if the mode can operate as another vibrational frequency, you see effects in both regimes. The effect is relatively small, but finite. Here is this regime enlarged, finite in the normal Marcus regime, because this mode contributes a term which is like a Frank Condon factor. The red is the Marcus result, the black is the cavity results, and you see that the rate is going down because this extra Frank Condon factor. But in the inverted Marcus regime, the cavity rate can become, this is a logarithmic scale, much higher than the rate outside the cavity, because now you can have photon generated assisted electron transfer in this regime. So basically we expect a really strongly modified Marcus inverted regime in this kind of calculations. Let's go quickly to another question. Can we do this experiment? And you know, if this was a normal Fabry-Perot cavity like people use for vibrational strong coupling, there is no way that we could do this experiment. We cannot do a single mole experiment. We have to go to what is called plasmonic cavities. This is some examples. So this is the one I showed you just a moment ago, done by this group and the group in Israel did another one. In plasmonic cavities, you can have very strong field. You can see single molecule effects. The catch is, of course, that with such small cavities, the cavity plasmon, to call it the cavity mode in this way, the frequency, if you use gold and silver, is very high. It's not vibrational frequency. You cannot do vibrational strong coupling or vibrational assisted, cavity mode assisted electron transfer in this kind of cavities. So you want to explore other cavities. But one thing to ask is, given different kind of cavities and different structures, how can I estimate the coupling or what is called the mode volume? And what we did is a little calculation for irregular cavities like this, or if you want to think of any irregular cavities based on the following observation. Here is the Hamiltonian of a molecule in a cavity, the matter, the light, and their coupling. Take the molecule as a two-level molecule. Here is the standard coupling between the molecule and the cavity. And what we want is, what we realize, we cannot use a Fabry-Perot type geometry. We have to use some irregular cavity. The expression is the same, but we do not know these coupling elements M. So this is what we want to estimate. And then what we do there is we replace the problem with another problem. We take the cavity mode, we put dissipation. This is just a boson field representing the dissipation of this cavity mode in the boundaries of the system. This is a plasmonic cavity, these are metals, going to be a lot of loss in this cavity. And then we add the cavity molecule coupling, but this is not a molecule. This is a classical dipole driving the system by oscillating at a given frequency. And the point, so this dipole is just given by this function. And the point is that this M coupling is the same M that I will need also for this other calculation of electron transfer, if you want, or any other molecular responses the cavity. All I want is to estimate this M for any cavity, these ones here or anything else. Analytically, we can calculate in linear response theory the outcome of this driving, and we get what we can calculate is the local reaction field on the dipole. This is a standard calculation. We can calculate this local reaction field on this dipole. The dipole drives the cavity exerts a field on the dipole. Analytical calculation for these structures or numerical calculation for any structure will lead, this is the analytical result that you get from this Hamiltonian. You can fit to any peak you see in any numerical calculation or any analytical calculation in the case of this cavities that you see here. And what you can get is the damping constant. This is the damping because of the coupling of this cavity mode to its environment, the resonance frequency, and this coupling M, which is related to the cavity volume. So basically, you know all of them. If we do it for these cavities with silver and gold, here is the cavity volume related, how it relates to M. And what we can calculate is this coupling M for any geometry. These are just two geometries, different distances between the surface and the gold. The cavity volume, the damping constant, the quality factor. And basically, it's clear that we cannot do this electron transfer effect that we predicted before for slow modes with this kind of frequency, 3.5 electron volts or 2.5 electron volts in case of gold. Vibrational frequencies are much lower, of course. This is not a case for vibrational strong coupling in this kind of environment. But look at this set of materials. These are doped semiconductors of different kind. And you can do the calculations for them as well. And you can see that with some doped semiconductions, the frequencies that we get, like 0.17 electron volts or 0.065 electron volts or anything in between, basically tells you with such semiconductor cavity, if you build your cavities from this kind of semiconductors, you can do vibrational strong coupling even on a single molecule. Of course, the Q factor is not great, so this will be the thing to fight with, but this is the direction one can get, and this is just, I will leave this to you as a possibility if anybody wants to study our predictions for electron transfer reactions. This leaves me less than 10 minutes to tell you about collective effects. So I will start with the standard model. Here is the ground state. Now we have N molecules. We consider just the singly excited state of such a system. We put it between two mirrors and we see the upper polariton and the lower polariton. And the Rabi splitting is proportional to the square root of the number. This is the standard things. And we all know about it. Experimentally, this is seen in, now if I focus on vibrational strong coupling, you can do this of course for other regimes. This is a demonstration for vibrational strong coupling from the Ebbesson group. This is another demonstration for Tal Schwartz and Fleischer in Tel Aviv University. Here they can change easily the resonance frequency, so you see very nicely the avoided crossing between the molecular mode and the cavity mode. So this is all there. But the really interesting thing, what I found, what everybody finds really exciting, is the experimental observations on the behavior of chemistry in these junctions. Here are the recent results that the Ebbesson group published on chemical rates. So I don't know if you can see, this is the rate as a function of temperature, but you can use the rate as a function of temperature for this kind of distillation reaction. I needed to go to Wikipedia to find out what distillation is. So I found what distillation is. You can imagine what distillation is too. Anyway, the rate of this reaction depends on temperature, but it depends on temperature differently when the molecule is in the cavity and out of the cavity. As a function of the Rabi splitting, you see big effect that suggests that these polaritonic effects are important for chemistry as well. And we would like to, everybody would like to understand the origin of this observation. And together with Joe Subotnick and, oh yeah, maybe I will go over this because I don't think I have enough time. This is another observation of collective effects. I will just show you that there are some interesting collective effects where you put molecule on a mirror and look at not the polaritonic line shapes, but at lifetimes. This is a Dickett type relaxation, except as a function of distance from a mirror, you see nice interference effect. There was interesting theoretical prediction that we did, and then Renaud Vallet did the experiment, and you see the collective effect and both in the and the interference also experimentally, but I will not talk about this. Let me tell you about what we did with Tao Li and Lo Subotnik. And the idea was that if there is an effect on equilibrium properties and on chemistry, we should see it in the potential of mean force of a single molecule. So basically you take your Hamiltonian, you integrate over all coordinates except the reaction coordinate, you get the potential of mean force on the reaction coordinate, and you want to do it in the cavity and outside the cavity. And because time is short, I will just show you the results we get. Basically, there are three statements in these transparencies. First, we do classical transition state theory. That is, everything we do is in classical mechanics, including the photon mode. But the photon mode, which is infrared, is like any other molecular nuclear mode. It is a relatively slow mode. There is a huge long history of studying molecular nuclear motion using classical mechanics. Of course, there are quantum corrections, but by and large, the effects that are seen can be at least qualitatively explained by classical mechanics, and this is what we do here. So we calculate the potential of mean force, and the bottom line is that there is an effect, but not in the Fabry-Perot type geometries that are done in most experiments to see the result I showed you before. Before here. So let me quickly go, and I will just mention there is now literature coming out, and here are some references of groups telling you about the same results. Not all of these statements are classical mechanics, but all leads to the fact that it's not evident that there is an effect in equilibrium. Now, there is one caveat here. If you have very small cavities like here, you can have the dipole-dipole coupling between the molecules affected by the proximity to metal walls. This is known for many, many years. You can see the calculation here. This is dipole-dipole coupling as a function of cavity length, but this is in nanometers. So this is this kind of couplings. And you see that when the cavity becomes smaller than 5 nanometers, you can change dipole-dipole coupling and you will see definitely effects that come from this. And this was emphasized by the in the paper by Gallego and co-workers last year. But when we do regular cavities, let me just walk you in one transparency. This is the molecule, this is the radiation field, that collective dipole. What we want is to calculate this. We want to do it in the ground state. So basically we take this Hamiltonian, we project it on the ground state. In the Hartree approximation, the ground state is a product. And you get the ground state Hamiltonian. The total Hamiltonian is the ground state molecular Hamiltonian. This one is what I will use. It will we do simulations in the dark or outside the cavity. This is still in the dark, but in the presence of molecule. There is a small quantum correction that I will not go into, except to say it is not collective. It depends on the number. The effect per molecule does not depend on the number of molecules. This term could depend on the number of molecules, but it is not in this integral. And you can appreciate why. If I take this Hamiltonian and put it here and integrate over everything, including this momentum, I remind you, this is the photomomentum, but photomomentum is just another coordinate I have to integrate with respect to. If I integrate this Gaussian here with respect to the photomomentum, this term will disappear. There will be no effect. And in fact, when you do a simulation, this is now water in a cavity, simulations done by Tao Li, and you can see outside the cavity, the OH bond picked here in the cavity. You see the upper and lower polaritons. You increase the density, or if you want, the Rabi splitting, the collective coupling, and the polariton becomes more separated. You see this, basically you see two very interesting physical effects here. First, the polariton lines are narrower, the free absorption, this is outside the cavity. Second, they are asymmetric, the upper one is more intense than the lower one, but there are also experiments. These are experiments again from the Ebison group, and this is the upper, this is the OH absorption outside the cavity. This is the upper polariton, this is the lower polariton. Interestingly, in this paper by the Ebison group, they explain the difference in intensities between the upper polariton and the lower polariton by different absorption of light in the metal interfaces and in the water, but we get it even without this effect. So this certainly can be there, but part of it, it just comes from the intermolecular water-water interaction. The important point is that when we calculate thermodynamic functions, this is the distribution of equilibrium, distribution of OH bond length. This is the pair distribution function. This is the velocity-velocity autocorrelation function. This is the center of mass velocity of the water molecules. We see no effects. There are two lines here. One of them is inside the cavity. One of them is the out of the cavity. They are basically on top of each other. The only time we see some effect is in the rotational correlation function. Here in the high frequency regime, there is some effect seen in the cavity that we do not see out of the cavity. We have to go back and check it, but I think this may be just, this is a very tiny effect. We really have to enlarge this to see it here. My expectation, this may be to do with water molecules getting absorbed on the metal, or, well, this is not a metal subcode, there is a spacer between the metal and the molecule, but on the surface itself, more water can change its orientation and therefore change its rotational properties. And I think this is maybe what we see there, nothing to do maybe with the optics itself. Anyway, please bring me to summary. So I think the most important observation for future studies is this really interesting observation of cavity effects on chemistry. It seems that there is an accumulated possibility, at least in classical mechanics, and in equilibrium, we do not see an effect, which does not mean there is no effect. We have to investigate this effect, taking more quantum input into account and see whether there is an interesting quantum effect there that we cannot reproduce in the classical limit. Another possibility is that the chemical rates that are observed are dominated not by equilibrium. When I say chemical reaction rates are by definition non-equilibrium. When I say equilibrium chemical rates, I really mean rates calculated or dominated by equilibrium properties, otherwise called transition state theory. Transition state theory is an equilibrium theory of chemical rates. It assumes that the equilibrium in the reactants remain intact by the chemical reaction. It also assumes that any molecule that has enough energy will make the reaction. There is no back reaction. Both these assumptions have to be checked to see if in the cavity environment they are modified. Let me quickly go you through backwards into the other things I showed you today. First, I did not have time for this, but I mentioned that there are collective and interference effects in the relaxation dynamics of emitters near a mirror, the work I did with Renaud and Maxime. I outlined a method to calculate the light-metal coupling in any cavity of irregular shape. If the shape is regular, we can do analytical calculation and fit any peak to the result we got for a driven cavity. This is irregular shape, we can still do it numerically, get the response numerically and fit to get the coupling strength. I talked to you about cavity effect on electron transfer rates, and we make the predictions that electron transfer rates in the inverted Marcus regime can be strongly affected by the cavity environment. In the normal Marcus regime, there is an effect, but modest, I would call it. And then going even more backwards, I told you a little bit, gave you a little overview of light effect in molecular conduction junctions. I talked about switching phenomena, voltage-induced light emission, and Raman scattering. So with this, I will leave you and thank you very much for being here. And I will be happy to take questions.
We have a question. One second. Go ahead, Joel.
Okay, thanks, Abe, for this very nice presentation. So I have two quick questions. Okay, so the first one is the small peaks that you see in the high frequency region of water when you put it inside of the cavity. So you associate that to just basically the fact that water molecules cannot rotate freely next to the interface of the metal. So I guess my question would be, as you, in principle, this if this were to be seen experimentally, as you increase the cavity longitudinal length, but still keeping resonance conditions, you should see that goes smaller and smaller, right? Because it's a surface effect. Am I correct to interpret it that way?
Well, first I would say it's not clear to me what we mean by resonance condition here. One observation in this kind of studies is that the resonant cavity frequency
doesn't matter.
Cavity effects are not necessarily related, at least in equilibrium. Catalytic can be, but as I said, we left behind quantum mechanics, we left behind non-equilibrium effects. There is still a lot to be learned about these systems. So there is definitely an effect we see numerically, these little peaks we see here. But this is not where the cavity resonance is.
But it would be a surface effect that, like, as you make the system size larger and larger, then the ratio of that with respect to the bigger peaks should go down. Is that the way I should look at it?
Well, you know, if I made the suggestions that this may reflect just molecules, the effect of boundaries on the molecular rotations. Mm-hmm. If I have more molecules in the bulk and relative to what I have in the boundary, then it should go down, if this is mm-hmm. true. Mm-hmm. But, you know, we did not check it yet. It just occurred to me when I prepared this talk, but Tao, who did this simulation, could simply look at a subset of the molecules, not take all the molecules, but just the molecules mm-hmm. next to the boundaries and see if this will amplify the effect. So this can be checked very easily, just that we did not do it yet.
Okay, thank you. Another quick question I had, when you were talking about your modified Marcus theory due to the cavity. So you add these counter rotating terms and these self dipole terms, and there is a lot of controversy in the literature about spin boson models or just spin systems coupled to a single photon mode and the problems of how to preserve gauge invariance in this type of model. So I guess my question would be, because ultimately this is a low energy model, low energy theory. Is there any subtlety there where, if I work in a different gauge, and I see that in your paper you really systematically derive this, but does this preserve gauge invariance? I guess that's my question.
All I can say, I expect it to be, because I don't recall doing anything that will raise doubts on, well, one need to be careful in many ways here. The moment you limit the cavity response to one mode, already you can create inconsistencies, and yes, these were discussed in the literature several times, and I leave it open. Basically, we take just a Hamiltonian, and this is the Hamiltonian, you can question whether we took enough care of this type of inconsistencies that surface when you limit the cavity response to a single mode. Except for that, I do not expect that we have a gauge problem here, but I have to admit we did not check it too carefully to say. Okay. I can say that this is the standard Hamiltonian one take for this kind of problems, but this is not a great answer, I admit, because mm-hmm. there is a lot of literature with standard Hamiltonians that eventually turned out to have problems, and I agree with you, this should be checked.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much.
In the interest of time, we'll take one more question, but you're feel free to post your questions in the Q&A, and then I can download those and send them off to Professor Nitzan so you can answer them when we have more time. So, Peng Fei?
Hey, Abe, Frank Hull from Rochester. Really nice talk.
Thank
so
you.
I'm just curious, maybe let me just quickly comment on Hoel's point, right, the gauge invariance. So it turns out, you know, you're working in the D.E. Hamiltonian, right, the dipole gauge. It turns out...
Well, actually, we started with the P.A. Hamiltonian, and this is after a transformation, but yes.
After Parazino-Woolley, sure. But it turns out, you know, if you want to truncate your matter subspace, and D.E. is much better Hamiltonian than P.A., the reason for that is... fundamental asymmetry between the Q operator and the P operator. Q operator often just couple, you know, or dipole operator just often couple, you know, a fewer states within the low energy subspace, but a P operator doesn't. You can easily see that because it will be the key dipole operator multiply the energy gap. So turns out if you do the same truncation in the P dot A Hamiltonian, usually it breaks down the gauge invariance. There are a couple of literature. We've been also working on this, how to restore gauge invariance.
I would love to learn about it. Can you send me a paper or two?
Absolutely. We're working on a draft. We'll send it to you soon.
Thank you.
Yeah, but also, my actual question is related to the collective effect.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't think it's valid to treat the photonic coordinate as a classical, like photonic degrees of freedom as a classical coordinate. Reason okay. for that is the frequency they're using is about 800 wave numbers. It's already quantum. You cannot populate, you know, all the states or, you know, in a classical Boltzmann distribution at room temperature,
mm-hmm.
right? Just like vibration. Vibration modes usually are quantum mechanical.
First, you are absolutely correct. I will never claim that you can take 800 wave numbers or 1,000 wave number modes and treat it classically, except that what I think what I was trying to convey is not that I think the results are absolutely quantitatively should reflect the experiment, except our experience with classical molecular dynamic studies of molecular system is that if we, and there are, you know, huge number of simulations on molecular system using classical fields, qualitatively molecular properties come out all right. That is, if you predict something so profound as collective effect, it has to be something very special. It is not zero point motion per se, not tunneling at the edge of some barriers. It has to be something very profound, and I submit that there might be. All I'm saying is that usually you expect that when you do classical simulations on nuclear motions of molecules, except in situations that we are familiar with, like when you have strong non-adiabatic effects where you have curve crossing. In this case, even then, we still treat the nuclei classically, but we try to take the non-diabetic effects by surface hopping methods and things like that. But if the motion is adiabatic limited to one electronic potential surface, usually you expect classical mechanics to give you qualitatively the correct physics. Maybe here it does not. If it is, then it will be extremely interesting to find out.
Yeah, I suspect it's probably not, because when you compute the free energy, right,
mm-hmm.
Change of free energy for your TST, you're assuming a thermal Boltzmann distribution for the photon field.
Mm-hmm.
Instead, I think you should just replace that by the sum of e to the negative beta, you know, EI.
This is being done now. Tau is doing these calculations as we speak, and probably in another month or two, we will have these results as well.
All right, thanks.
Sure.
And then if you could stop sharing your screen, Professor Nitzan, and
also,
if you could quickly just wrap this up. All right. Well, thank you all for attending. And then I just wanted to announce that our next speaker will be Stefan Kinnick-Cohen from Montreal. Again, it's at Wednesday, 9 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. And don't forget to register using this link. We'll be posting this on Twitter and also sending out email in the near future. And again, thank you all for attending.